I'm presenting new work we did. It's not my work. Huh? We are a lot working on that subject about human annotation of ICER era regions, and specifically we were interested by the notion of gravity era, and we want to be sure that we all speak about the same thing when we are speaking about era gravity. The context of this work is the INR-VERA project, and there are different laboratories involved in this project, LIUM, LNI, LPP, and LIMC, and I think that everybody almost will speak during this workshop. The general objective of this project is to work on ICER and to try to propose errors, ICER errors typology and classification. In order to improve evaluation metrics within ISR systems for confidence scores, for example, and for task evaluation. Task evaluation, I mean further task evaluation, task applied on the ISR output. We also want to try to integrate within the systems error knowledge. The systems we are working on are named entity detection, spoken language understanding, and question answering. So, here are some classical observations. First of all, of course, ISR systems produce many things, amazing, but errors. And we do not like these errors. First of all, when we work on system applied on ISR outputs, we just can observe a very huge decrease of the system performance when system applied from manual transcription to automatic transcription. And we often say that we have too many errors, but actually things are not so simple. For example, here it is a very simple example of the performance obtained by named entity detection system applied on three different ICER outputs on the two different kinds of data, broadcast news and broadcast conversation. First of all, you can see the decrease of the performance on the green line. It's a slot error rate that I use in this figure. You can see that even with almost the same word error rate, named entity detection system can have a very different slot error rate. So we can say that not all errors have the same importance, and of course that word error rate is not always, almost never, a good indicator for all the for following task success. So, if we take a look of work done in the side of automatic speech recognition, we know that a few studies focus on error analysis, and most of them were about the major causes of errors. Some of them on error classification, others on comparison between automatic and human performances. There have been very few studies on ICER error gravity in link with further processing. And that's what we wanted to do. But actually, at least in one complete different field of research, teaching, foreign language teaching, second language teaching, there have been a few works on error evaluation. There is two examples of such studies, one from Davis in 83 and the other one in 2006, and these two studies try to compare the way teachers label error gravity within student work. They too have the almost same conclusion, which is that the viewpoints, the experience, the background is very important for this labeling task. So when we begin this this work, we wanted to know because we were we were speaking about error gravity. We wanted to know at first if we really speak about the same thing. So we begin this study having in mind a few questions. The first one being that: do we use the same way to evaluate the error gravity? And then, are we really consistent when we label error zone, or is that like something random trial? And if it's not a random trial, that is what we would like to be. When we label, when we use a gravity scale, do we follow the same strategies, or do our the labeler strategies is depending on their personal competence and interests? So finally, what we were interested in is to see if there is a shareable generic view of gravity concept. So the experiment. We use three different shows in French from the étape corpus with the ISR provided by Lium and the alignment between ISR and hypothesis done by LNE. The first one is a radio show debate, the third one also, and the second one is a parliamentary debate, almost the same Juliette showed you previously. We did not work on the world level, but we defined error zone, considering that all the consecutive words in the hypothesis, which are different from the reference, fall into this error zone. So you have some numbers of the corpora. The corpus 1 and corpus 3 have almost the same number of words. The number of error zones is quite different, so. And the ratio of words falling into the error zone is different, so. You can see that we do not have to... that's very important. So, seven annotators with distinct background annotated the data. We have three linguists working now in natural language processing or spoken language processing, two linguists and two computer scientists. Every one annotated in the same order the different corpus. Corpus 1, 2, 3, and then 1 again. And this allowed us to compare and to work on agreement scores, inter and intra annotator agreement scores. Because we want to verify whether we really speak about the same thing, we do not use precise guidelines. And we consider that there are only three levels, low and high, the two most important, and intermediate, which is a level that annotator has to choose only if he were not able to choose between the low level or high level of gravity. We use a very simple interface, web interface, which allows to see the reference and the hypothesis. The error zone was underlined, and the annotators can, using the arrow key, see the past and the future of the document, if you want. So first results, very raw numbers. First of all, we can see that annotators differ in their error gravity assessment. For example, the first annotator one tend to annotate more at the low level, while A2, 5 and 6 tend to use more and more the high level gravity scale. If we take a look at the distribution of perfect consensus, we can see that we have a low number of perfect consensus. Perfect consensus is when all the annotators choose the same label, and there is no consensus at all on the intermediate level. So we, of course, have very low general kappa. We use the multi-annotator flies kappa. But we can, instead of looking at the inter-annotator agreement, we can only train to see if there is some majority voting for one scale, one level or another. And that exactly what we can see in this figure. A majority, the circle are the represent the number of vote, and you can see that the majority is on the third, the level three, or at the level one, and the bigger the circle, the bigger the more the vote you have on this label. That for all the four corpus, four corpora, and is the same for the different corpus. You can see that corpus 1 and corpus 4 allows to obtain almost the same figure, while corpus 2 is clearly different. Corpus 2 is the one with the lower number of error zones and the lower number of words within falling within an error zone. Another way to look at our classification is to consider that actually we have three different classes. The first one being majority vote of low level of gravity judgments, one high level of gravity judgment at most. The second one, class B, being that we have a majority of vote of high level of gravity and at most one low level of gravity judgment, and C, all the others. And that confirms what we saw on the figure previously, that is that we have a clear majority on high and low level of gravity. Here, you have some, you have the confusion matrix, and what I want to show you that is the possible or not possible agreement, taking into account the background or not, and the task understanding, the annotator thing to do. If we had an agreement based on the background, we should have high agreement between A1, A2, and A7, for example, which is absolutely not the case. We should have a high agreement between A4 and A5, which is absolutely not the case, and the same for A3 and A6. We should have, we asked the annotator to tell, actually, we were the annotator, what is the task? What do you think you did when you annotated the data? We have different answers. Everyone saying that it's an understanding task. A1 considering that the task, generally speaking, is a simple slot filling task. E4, 5, 6 considered it as being a general understanding task. I don't know exactly what it is. Ace even considered that it is an understanding task, but for factual question answering task, which is another thing, and I think it's more close to the slot filling issue. And A2 and A3 consider that a serious error is when you do not have the same understanding of the sentence when reading either the hypothesis or the reference. And we do not have agreement if we cluster the annotator given the task definition. But we have agreement between, correct agreement between some of the annotator pair. We proceed to the annotation of the of one of the corpus two times at the beginning and at the end of the annotation task. The first corpus it allows to do intra annotator agreement, and what you have the kappa, and what you can see is that even if the agreement is higher than between all the annotators, we only have between 0.6 and 0.7 agreement. If we look at the differences between the change of the annotation label between corpus 1 and corpus 2, in most of the cases we have modification as in this example, that means moves between high and intermediate level, or sometimes intermediate level and low level. And this goes in the same sense of the observation I did before about the majority vote. We also try to look if we can distinguish the labeling between some automatic difference between hypotheses and references, and we use a simple edit distance. And what we can see here is that we have a majority annotation on the I on the high gravity label when we have high distance, edit distance measure, and that we have, of course, the smaller the edit distance, the most annotation we have on the low level. That's the same for the different corpora, and the first and the fourth one offer almost the same figures. The second one is still very different compared to the other one. If here are some examples that illustrate that the edit distance is not a good way to do this comparison. For the same edit distance, let's say 5, for example, we can have complete different thing, and of course, complete different labeling. For example, vous chantez pas, j'ai dit, parce que bla bla bla, you don't, which means you don't sing, I said, and the hypothesis being the exact same thing, except that the verb is in the present and instead of the past. But with the same edit distance, we can have a very different meaning. Let's say that yes, in the reference, and one eye in the hypothesis. So it was a very first step of the study. We begin on the ICER errors and the human judgment on ICER errors. First of all, we can say that each annotator has its own interpretation of the task. Generally speaking, we do not have a strong agreement in terms of kappa, but we have a clear majority vote. And we can make some expected observations like the higher the distance between ref and hip, better the agreement, and so on. Also, we did some comparison based on the post label, and it's almost the same, thing. If the hypothesis lost a substantive or a verb, the vote is at the high level, and so on. So the next steps for our work will be to take into account to further take into account semantic or morphosyntactic categories. When I say semantic, I think about name entity actually. And to develop annotation guidelines, first by examining all cases with a majority and define the error gravity given the results of this first labeling task. And also by integrating task knowledge, we consider that we need a task definition to know whether an error is serious or not, which is something expected actually. And we are in the process of setting up some experiment in order to study the human performance in classification of error given a task. So, if you have questions. For the moment, what we did is the exact same thing as here, but instead of based on the study about the eddy distance, we look at the post tag within the ref, the reference, the reference, and if and we compute if in we compute the vote and the majority vote against an error zone, taking into account the kind of post present in the zero zone. Yeah. Something like that. And it is obvious that we have very obvious results. When you have verb or substantive in the error zone, then you have high level majority vote. It's not the case when you have adjectives, determinant, and so on. I thought actually that adjectives will allow the same kind of behavior than a verb or noun, but it's not the case. Yes.
Sophie, I think this is not this is at a different level from what you are doing here, but you might be interested in some work that Steve Whitaker and I did a few years back.
Yeah, yeah.
Where we tried to see what the effect of different word error rates was on people performing different tasks. So
that's something when I no. Here. Yeah, yeah. That's what we are beginning to do, actually. And of course, we will use what you already did. Yeah.